I should like to try today to submit to you for discussion, nothing more, indeed a kind of theoretical analysis of the situation in which the radical movement finds itself today. I want to say from the beginning that I still consider the radical student movement and the black and brown militants in this country as the only real opposition we have. There is no other one, or if there is, at least it remained concealed to me. I hope that the analysis I try to give you is indeed a Marxist analysis. If Marxism means more than regurgitating concepts that were elaborated 100 years ago. It is difficult for me to engage in such a theoretical analysis when the things that are happening all around us seem to cry for action, no matter what action, for action so that we don't suffocate, so that we don't bust up. It is very difficult to engage in a theoretical analysis when the Orwellian language has become the normal medium of communication between the government and the people, and even to a great extent among the people themselves. However, the Orwellian language is not only a blatant lie and contradiction, it is also expressive of the facts. We terminate the war in Indochina by extending it. We withdraw by invading. We dismiss charges against alleged massacres in Vietnam, I quote, in the best interest of justice, and so on and so on. It seems to me that here we have, strange as it may seem, the linguistic expression of the real contradictions of capitalism today. Because it is simply correct that this society can have peace only by preparing for war or by even waging war. It is simply correct that it can mitigate or temporarily resolve conflicts only by expanding and creating conflicts somewhere else. Now, the analysis I want to submit to you starts with two theses, which I shall now read. First, the close of the 20th century may well mean the advent of the first world historical revolution. Two, the progress of this revolution is counteracted by a preventive counter-revolution, because there was no revolution preceding it, a preventive counter-revolution organized on a global scale and centered in the United States. A few words in illustration of these theses. The coming revolution, if it comes, and you will see this is by no means certain, the coming revolution will be a world historical revolution because for the first time in history, society disposes over all the resources for abolishing poverty and exploitation the world over. It will be a world historical revolution because of the emergence of a powerful revolutionary potential in the third world, affecting the metropoles of capitalism themselves in the rise of the oppressed minorities. It will be a world historical revolution because we have in China the development of a new form of socialism, not following the authoritarian bureaucratic model. And we still have the very existence of the Soviet Union and the Soviet orbit as perhaps potentially objective anti-capitalist powers. Now, against these prospects, indeed threatening for the system, we have the organization of counterinsurgency on an unprecedented scale at home and abroad. It is not only to prevent the revolution, it is also to counteract the aggravating contradictions of the capitalist system today. That is, most generally, the blatant conflict between the vast productive forces and their private control and utilization demands the increasing restriction, the increasing perversion and distortion of the productive forces. It demands constantly renewed plant obsolescence and waste. However, I think we see already today that even the most rigorously organized capitalist restraint and destruction of productive forces can for any length of time halt the decline in the rate of profit, the inflation, and so-called technological unemployment. Now this picture, and I will try to fill it out as I go on, this picture seems to corroborate one of the central theses of Marxian theory, which apparently were refuted by the actual developments in the 20th century up to now, namely the thesis that a truly socialist society is possible only on a worldwide scale, and that such a revolution would start in the most highly developed industrial country. In other words, the capitalist chain must be broken not at its weakest, but at its strongest link. Why this is so, I think we can see today very clearly. Just consider for one moment what a radical change in the imperialist metropole would do on a global scale. It would mean the collapse of the lackey regimes in the third world, and not only in the third world. It would remove a major obstacle to the development of the European revolutions. It would allow an independent development of the Chinese and Cuban revolution. And perhaps it would mean a political upheaval in the Soviet Union itself. Moreover, this new quantitative scope of the potential revolution suggests also a qualitative difference between it and the preceding revolutions. Namely, the first revolution, based on the achievements of industrial society, it could from the beginning assume a total character, namely, finally the abolition of man's subordination to the instruments of his labor, the productive and progressive reduction of alienated labor, two possible developments which would in turn make for an economic, political, and cultural revolution. All three in one, and already by virtue of this scope, far outdoing the preceding revolutions. And it would, for the first time in history, make possible the construction of integral socialism, not only indefinitely postponed to a second phase which never may arrive, but the construction of integral socialism from the beginning. This novel historical situation calls for a re-examination of the preconditions and of the presumptive strategy of the radical opposition under the preventive counter-revolution. I would like to take as point of departure the structural changes which have taken place within the capitalist system since the Second World War, and I will mention only the main tendency. To the degree to which the international concentration of economic power progresses, individual capitals are increasingly subjected to the interest of capital as a whole, and capital is ever more directly and immediately fused with the state, with the government. Dependence of capital on the political and military power structure, increasing interference of government in the economy, to such an extent that even in this country, the word nationalization is no longer a dirty word, that even in this country, one considers the nationalization of certain large enterprises. In other words, what we witness is that monopoly capitalism tends toward state capitalism. What does it mean for the social stratification? It means that ever more strata of the middle classes depend on monopoly capital. They are occupied in the realization, if not in the creation of surplus value. Thus, with this transformation of capitalism, we witness the extension of exploitation beyond the class of industrial and agricultural labor, and we witness the emergence of what has been called a new working class of educated labor, necessitated by the increasingly technological and scientific character of the process of production. And at the same time, owing to the technical progress in the productivity of labor, this type of capitalism can indeed bring an increased standard of living to a large part of the population. Consequence, what I called the integration of a large majority, including organized labor, into the system. The class struggle does not disappear. It cannot possibly disappear before the abolition of class society itself. But it proceeds in the well-known classical forms of an economic contest on trade union terms. This transformation now brings us to the, I guess for you also, decisive question. Is the traditional working class, the blue-collar working class, still the social base of the potential revolution? Or is the transformation of capitalism creating a new, not smaller, but larger base? There is a widespread, but rather insufficient and un-Marxist answer to this question on the part of those who maintain that just as before, industrial labor, and mainly blue-collar labor, provides the base for the revolution. The answer is that if the laboring masses today in the most advanced industrial countries, and I stress once and for all, it refers only to the most advanced industrial countries. If the laboring masses in these countries are not revolutionary, perhaps even anti-revolutionary, then, so it is said, it is because their consciousness lags behind their social existence. Thus, we have the well-known conflict between the subjective and the objective factors. I consider this answer not only as inadequate, but as totally un-Marxist. Because if we know anything of Marx, we ought to know that he believes that it is the social existence which determines the consciousness, and the answer must therefore be thought in the social existence, in the objective conditions of the working class today, and only in a secondary way in their consciousness. Or, to put it in a shorter form, if indeed the consciousness of the working classes has changed, it is because the objective conditions of the working class have changed. What has happened to bring about such a change? I propose that what we have witnessed was a new stabilization of capitalism, a stabilization of capitalism on a twofold ground, namely brutal expansion abroad, economic, political, and military expansion, and secondly, and closely related to it, neo-colonization in the interior and abroad. What has this stabilization of capitalism achieved? Competitive, scientific, and technical progress has created whole new branches of industry and has enlarged the internal and external market, while at the same time the growing productivity of labor counteracted the decline in the rate of profit and made possible that relatively high standard of living for the working classes. Now this transformation is accompanied by, and I think this is for a Marxist analysis decisive, by a growth in what is called the tertiary sector of the economy, namely the publicity industry, services, entertainment, and so on. And this growth of the tertiary sector, in which mainly services are produced, this growth means that an increasing part of the working population today is employed in unproductive labor, in Marxian terms. That is to say, labor which does not produce material commodities, which does not produce capital, as Marx says, and which is therefore not proletarian. That is not I, that is Marx, Capital, Modern Library Edition, Volume 1, page 673, footnote. But he says even more disagreeable things. The assimilation of a large part of the working class to the middle classes, that is to say to those middle classes who do not belong to the ruling classes, is therefore not merely ideological and a surface phenomenon, but is originating in the productive process itself. Let me again quote from Marx, Theories of Surplus Value, Volume 1. Unfortunately, I have only the German edition, and the German edition, it is page 324 and following. There he says, and it is one of the most amazing anticipations, with the growing productivity of labor, an ever larger part of the population is employed in non-material production. These include intellectual producers. They form an ever more essential base of capitalist reproduction in the realization, and we can add today, even creation of surplus value. Does this mean? It certainly means it's decisive change in the composition of the working class. Does it mean that the working class is no longer the revolutionary subject? Certainly not. As long as labor remains the human base of the productive process, the working class will remain its political base, but it will be a very different and very extended working class. We have terrible difficulties in finding today the revolutionary subject, because we look for it as if the revolutionary subject were a thing that somewhere exists ready-made, or at least half ready-made, and just has to be found. We have to get rid, in addition to this wrong approach, of the fetishism of labor, of the mystification of the class concept, and realize that the revolutionary subject emerges in the struggle itself. Only in the struggle itself can it become a revolutionary subject, and that a class changes with changes in the productive process. These changes suggest, first, that the revolutionary subject would be an extended and transformed working class in which labor, in the traditional sense, blue-collar labor, would only be one and at present the least active element. These changes suggest, secondly, that the subjective motives and mainsprings of the revolution would be in non-material needs. This is the qualitative difference of this revolution from the preceding one, if and when the material needs are satisfied. In other words, this revolution would indeed, for the first time, put on the agenda the self-determination of man in all spheres and dimensions of his life, and not only at work in labor. At the present stage, capitalism operates on the back of the vast majority of the population, separated from control over the means of production. They spend their life in alienated work, but they are not a proletariat in the classical sense. They are not living in abject poverty like the former. Large part of it are rather bourgeois in outlook, values, and aspirations, though very different from the small class that rules this society. And underneath this vast majority, underneath it, the large number of the underprivileged racial and national minorities, unemployed and unemployable, at the margin of the regular process of production. This, I think, is a new techno-structure of exploitation. Growing productivity of labor, constantly augmenting the wealth of commodities and services, but intensified meaningless work and performances required for producing, buying, and selling these goods and services, and a scientific control of consciousness and instincts, that is to say, domination through steered satisfaction and steered aggression. Who is in control of this techno structure of exploitation? Charles A. Reich has written a fiction bestseller, #1, The Greening of America. It should be a fiction bestseller. Unfortunately, it is not listed under fiction, in which he maintains, literally and at many places, nobody is in control. And since nobody is in control, nothing can possibly be easier than the revolution. And therefore, it is self-understood that the revolution will be without any violence on either side. Now, I think you all agree with me. We wish that would be the case. It isn't our fault that it ain't the case. And I think it can pretty clearly be answered who is in control. However, there is one decisive difference. Those who are in control, those small groups of military, of politicians, of economic power, they are no longer, and I think this is important, they are no longer a ruling class which develops the productive forces. but rather it does the opposite, perverting and destroying them in the service of an ever more desperate offensive system. Offensive to such an extent that even its offensive abroad is no longer primarily economically founded, but driven by the all-out struggle against communism in the interest of prolonging the status quo. And as long as this power structure of exploitation is sustained by an intrinsically conservative majority, the political class struggle is indeed transformed into an international struggle, with the national liberation movements and their counterparts in the metropoles as the objectively anti-capitalist forces. But this is not the basic tendency. It is not the basic tendency because we remember that without the internal weakening of the heartland of global capitalism, these external forces will not be able to assert themselves for any length of time. And these inner contradictions of the capitalist system indeed appear today in a new historical form in the so-called consumer society, which is the highest stage of capitalism. The contradiction appear in the so-called consumer society, first in a seemingly ideological, rather even psychological way. They assert themselves as the, I think, increasing dysfunctioning of the system, the dysfunctioning of its operational values, which are essential for the reproduction of the system, the increasing loosening of the moral fiber and cohesion of the society, the weakening of work discipline, responsibility and efficiency, the complete denial of that spirit of innerworldly asceticism, which was until not too long ago the mainspring of capitalism. The contradictions assert themselves in all sorts of dropouts, withdrawals, dissociations, by no means only among the rebellious middle class, and even reaching the ruling class itself. In short, we see in this so-called consumer society a largely unpolitical, diffuse, non-directed, and yet profound non-identification with the system. This, I propose, is the reverse, is the soil beneath the noisy, hysterical, and well-propagandized identification with the system. It is a ground still shifting, still weak, but bound to get larger and stronger because, and I think this is decisive, this rebellion against the behavior patterns and values required by the capitalist system is not only generated by the system itself, but also constantly promoted and aggravated by the system. How does the consumer society manage to drive the internal contradictions to an ever greater intensity. At the present stage, capitalism creates, alongside the world of alienated labor, misery and repression, a world of ease, gadgets, enjoyment, services, in which increasing numbers of people participate, though largely in a precarious way. The wealth of capitalist societies is still, as Marx defined it, an immense accumulation of commodities. But commodities which require an increasingly smaller quantity of labor power for their production, that is to say, provide an increasingly smaller source of surplus value. And capitalist wealth is made up of an increasing mass of services, products of unproductive labor. Thus, we see the near starvation of the investment and commodity market. In other words, the consumer society demonstrates in a very tangible form the internal limits of capitalist production. Or could it be that the consumer society is the grave digger of capitalism? Let me read to you a non-technical description of this internal development, which I found in the French paper Le Monde. I quote, "The development of the tertiary sector," I have already explained what that means, "that of services, henceforth takes place at an accelerated rhythm. It absorbs growing demands and calls for ever increasing unproductive investment." That is to say, investments that no longer yield the necessary rate of profit. The growth of this sector creates a disequilibrium in the balance of forces, which up to now has entirely turned on the multiplication of goods and the profitability of production. It is not a paradox if the producer begins to recede more and more before the consumer, if the will to produce weakens before the impatience of a consumption for which the acquisition of the things produced is less important than the enjoyment of things living. The revolt of the young generation against the consumer society is nothing else than an intellectual manifestation of the will to go beyond the industrial, that is to say, capitalist era, nothing else than the search for a new profile of society beyond a society of producers. This is the sense in which the consumer society may well become the grave digger of capitalism. And you have seen from the last paragraph I read to you how here the rebellion of the young is understood far better than in most cases it understands itself, as indeed an expression and outflow of tendencies that go on in the production sphere of the society itself, that is to say, of basic tendencies and not only of ideological tendencies. I will now, what I promised to do, try to give a very brief sketch how I see the situation of the radical movement today. And I will be perfectly frank. I believe that the more the movement, in spite of its apparently elitist character, expresses an objective radical potential in the society at large, the more it articulates, though often unconsciously, the internal contradictions at this stage in their new historical form. And that is why the ruling class today, far more intelligent than we give it credit for, knows perfectly well where the enemy in the own country is. The full weight of suppression is directed against the black and brown militants and against the schools, colleges, and universities. It is not directed against organized labor. It doesn't have to be directed against organized labor. This is the preventive counter-revolution. Not yet the American fascism. We are far from a fascist form of government, but some of the possible preconditions are emerging. They are well known to you, and I just give you a list. The courts, more and more used as political tribunals, the reduction of education and welfare in the richest country in the world, anti-democratic legislation such as preventive detention and the no-knock laws, economic sanctions if you are politically and otherwise suspect, the intimidation of the mass media, the self-censorship of the mass media. These are very frightening signs. You can say history repeats itself. It never repeats itself in the same form. The fact that we cannot point to any charismatic leader, the fact that we cannot point here to any SS and SA, simply means that these are not necessary in this country, that other organizations can, if necessary, perform the job they performed, perhaps even more efficiently. And I don't have to tell you which organizations I have in mind. Now, in the face of this counter-revolution, the movement is badly hit, deprived of formerly effective action. What was all right still a year ago can no longer be done today. Divided in itself and in search of a new strategy. What I suggest is that what is at stake today is the self-preservation of the movement as a political force. And that would mean one step backward in order to be able to take two steps forward. I would like in these terms to discuss very briefly. I can make only short remarks. First, the division within the movement. Secondly, the problem of alliances and the extension of the base. Thirdly, the question of organization versus spontaneity. Fourth, from personal to social liberation. And fifth, self-destruction, anti-intellectualism. I'm afraid I can, as I said, give you only very few remarks. That would be delightful if you would take them as material for discussion. Now, first, the division of the movement. Let me start by saying that the division of the movement itself is not necessarily detrimental. We have seen that in Russia, where the split between Bolsheviks and Mensheviks did not exactly prevent the Russian Revolution, and we have seen it in China. The division makes sense, can make sense, if it is a question of a realistic mass strategy, if it is a question of testing of consciousness, strength, readiness, and so on. But ideological differences and divisions become utterly irrelevant and ridiculous where such a mass base is only to be created. Then the conflicts become merely ideological, and they usually terminate in the ritualized discussions, in a rhetoric that lives and moves in a fantasy world with no relation to reality, and that is apt to antagonize from the beginning possible sympathizers, because simply terms and concepts and words are used which may make and should make very good sense among ourselves, terms such as imperialism, exploitation, capitalism, I certainly used it enough tonight, but which make no sense whatsoever if you want to persuade and convince what we may call outsiders, until and unless you can translate them into ordinary language. This is one of the very rare cases where I am in favor of ordinary language. If you can translate them into ordinary language, all right, it should be possible to translate them in this way. By and large, I suggest that whatever ideological differences may exist in the movement can and should be safely bracketed, suspended for better times, when they are more realistic. They should be suspended in favor of united action on common issues, in favor of an action which, precisely because it is organized around a concrete and transparent issue, can indeed extend the base of the movement. The so-called battle for the streets does not require ideological puritanism. On the contrary, such a puritanism in this situation can be fatal to the progress of the movement. Second, the problem of alliances and of compromises. I'm sorry, and it took me a long time to admit, and I'm still willing to be convinced or persuaded of the opposite, but I believe that under the counter-revolution there is indeed such a thing as a lesser evil. It has been a lesser evil. It has been said that a true revolutionary knows when to make compromises and what compromises to make. We are in a very bad and in a very serious situation, a situation in which even such things as a fight for the recovery and restoration of civil rights is and should be on the agenda. In such a bad situation that it is almost horrible to pronounce it, even some temporary alliances and compromises with certain liberals seem to be on the agenda. It may be good for many things. For example, it may be very good, and let's be vulgar materialists for a while, it may be very good and maybe very helpful if you could get what is one of the bitterest and gravest defects of the left today, namely the total lack of funds, money. You can't get it if you go to them and come with imperialism and capitalism and exploitation, but you may perfectly well be able to persuade them when you keep these concepts for those who know what is meant by them. Secondly, and most importantly, the movement and the working class. Now, I have already said that it is nonsense to say that a revolution is even imaginable without the working classes. I have immediately added that we are confronted with structural changes within the working class. And can we say anything about a possible alliance between the student movement and the working classes? Let me say from the beginning, I believe that this is not the question of alliances, but the question of a junction between two social and political forces. And this junction depends on the progress of capitalist destabilization, in which both forces, the student movement on the one hand and labor on the other, operate on their own base and in their own rights. The students today are not a Leninist avant-garde by any stretch of the imagination, because you cannot have an avant-garde where there is no mass movement behind the avant-garde. What does that mean in practice? If we expect the junction as a process, a point which is approached by the two social and political forces, each on their side, and their own side. It means, above all, that the slogan, "Go to the workers," is utterly insufficient, quite apart from its ridiculous patronizing character. It isn't done with going to the workers, leafletting at the factory gates, and perhaps even visiting a factory gate. Rather, either you really become a worker and continue to work in the factory, or we have a division of functions, for which I will give you an example that was tested with success in Italy, which has some experience in these things. The proletarian left, that is the name of the organization of which I speak, has decided to change its strategy and to arrive at a complete division of functions. That is to say, the students work out their information and propaganda material and give it to the base committees in the factories, which consist exclusively of workers and which will use this material the way it fits their own situation. That is only one example how there can be cooperation with division of functions and without trying to obliterate the obvious gap between these two forces today. Fourth, the question of organization. I believe, and I said it before, that the traditional mass parties of the past are outdated. Again, outdated, primo, because there are not yet any revolutionary masses. You cannot have a mass party if you don't have any masses. Secondly, because these centralized mass parties, we are part and parcel of the system of parliamentary democracy. And parliamentary democracy is no longer a vehicle of radical change. These centralized mass parties can easily be rendered ineffective by the removal of the leadership. Instead, what seems to be shaping up, what was tested in France and in Italy, is the centering of the movement on local and regional organizations of a united front with bracketed and suspended ideological differences, local and regional committees capable of organizing popular rather than radical action on common issues. Issues are there plenty. It is today a question of organization and coordination. I want to stress it here, and it somehow hurts to stress it. But I believe that the period of beautiful spontaneity, the period of personal anti-authoritarianism, of yippie rock and shock, that this heroic period of the movement is over. Not because the movement has become weaker, but because it is growing and is becoming more serious. This heroic period is over because the establishment has become self-conscious of the danger of its power in organizing the counter-revolution. The establishment has become immune against shock, completely immune against ego trips styled as political actions. It is in response to the growing difficulties of the capitalist system that the movement now is faced with the task of establishing its own authority also in its own ranks and with its own members. No premature anarchism. Anarchism may be good. I believe, and I said before, that a strong element of anarchism should be incorporated into Marxism. To do it now in the face of a deadly, powerful enemy, it is premature. What remains is that there can be no social liberation without personal liberation. But also, no personal, no individual liberation without the political struggle against prevailing in unfreedom on a social scale. Now, what about the framework of action? What strategy is left under the counter-revolution? I can think of a no better characterization of a strategy than the one given by my young friend Rudi Dutschke when he spoke and still speaks of the long march through the institutions. The long march through the institutions. This is not and does not mean and never was supposed to mean the deadly game of parliamentary democracy. Today, all radical opposition is necessarily extra-parliamentary opposition. You just cannot compete in the pseudo-democratic process. You are not millionaires, and you are not able to buy the machinery which is required in order to be successful and influential in this process. So certainly not the pseudo-democratic process, but I think one can still, relatively generally at least, define what is meant by this strategy. First, such a strategy does include demonstrations, extended demonstrations, well-organized demonstrations for clearly identified issues. This strategy includes the organization of radical caucuses, counter-meetings, counter-associations, in short, the development of what has been called counter-institutions, such as radio, television, press, workshops, anything and everything that may promise to break the information monopoly of the establishment. But above all, the long march through the institution means going into the institutions, learning how to do the job which hopefully you will show others how to do it in a free and freer society, learning how to do the job, educating yourself and others on the job, and preparing for the time when the job has to be done for a new and for a free society. But against this not very attractive and certainly not very spectacular strategy, we have what I now really call the pest that infects the new left, a handout to the establishment, one of the fifth columns of the establishment in the new left, namely the widespread anti-intellectualism that has infested the movement. If you want to hate yourselves, if you are ashamed of what you happen to be, if you are masochistic to the degree of self-destruction, in other words, if you want to really be effectively anti-intellectual, then take a job in the office of the Vice President of the United States, or in the office of Governor Reagan, or wherever they wish. because they certainly know how to do that much better than you do and much more effectively. Marx's famous thesis has been interpreted as meaning today it is no longer necessary to understand and interpret the world. We can simply go ahead and change it. An idiotic interpretation, because never has the effort of thinking, of knowing what is going on and what can be done about it, been greater than it is today. And today, more than ever before, there cannot possibly be any revolutionary practice without the theory guiding such practice. The Marxian thesis means to understand, to interpret the world in order to change it. But it does not give an alternative, a productive alternative to interpreting and understanding it. Now, the power of false consciousness, this material force of ideology, is sweeping today even the new left, sweeping it in its rhetoric, sweeping it in its withdrawal, sweeping it in its confusing of private liberation with social and political, and even more, in its attitude towards those institutions which you can still use for a better purpose than they are being used now. I know perfectly well, and my relation to the university has been long enough, I know your criticism of education. I know how much of it, very much of it, is justified. But what is not justified under any circumstances is the slogan, destroy the university, because it is a pillar of the establishment. The university is a pillar of the establishment. It is up to you to make it something different within the university. But you don't cut off the branch on which you are sitting, because you are made a radical in the university if you are halfway in tenure. In other words, not destroy, but radically reconstruct the university. That should be the task. Because today, the demand precisely for radicals should be not less education, but more education. We need infinitely more education than we have now in order to be able to cope with the things that will come and will come very soon. Again, if you want to destroy the universities, leave it to the power structure. That is exactly what the power structure is doing. And you have only to look at your own budget in order to see how effective they will be able to do it. So do not compete with people who can do it infinitely better than you can. Maybe it just occurred to me it is only because I quit it that I now have a praise of the university, but I think it is somehow a little more sincere than that. And I cannot take one word back from it, because I still believe that it is in the schools and universities that there are more or less hidden all the facts, all the theories, all the possibilities we need, and that it is up to us to get this material. And if you don't get the material, if you have courses and seminars, I was told sometimes it happens even in seminars, if you have courses where you know something is wrong, where you know vital facts are not treated, are not discussed, then criticize this course without any compromise. There's only one trouble. If you really want to do that effectively, you must know the facts better than the teacher knows them. I would like to add immediately, I think that this is perfectly possible and not even very difficult. Now let me conclude by repeating, which I think is really one of the main points, that neither the sexual revolution, if there was such a thing, nor any other personal or individual or group liberation will be a vehicle of social liberation unless these private and particular liberation movements transcend individual and group gratifications, unless they are subjected to a new rationality and become part of a theory and practice of social change. I started by saying how strong the desire, the need is for action. There is, however, a distinction between activism and action. All revolutionary action is based on popular support. In this country, this popular support is shaping up in the ghettos. It does not yet exist for the student movement. Violence is institutionalized in the establishment. The movement can only defend itself against violence. It is not, and it cannot be, on the offensive. There have been enough martyrs and enough victims. As I said at the beginning, you have to preserve your strengths as a political force. You have to become those who prepare the soil, the minds and the bodies for a new society. If you don't do it, who does? And you have to do all this while you are still alive, while you are still young, while you are still capable of thinking, of talking, of loving, and of resisting and fighting. Thank you.